Hi guys, it's NAMM 2019 and we are here with Rob Chapman. I could have said, guitarist extraordinaire, company owner.
Wanker.
All sorts of things. So just go with Rob Chapman. I think the guys know who you are. So how are you enjoying NAMM so far?
I'm loving NAMM so far. It's a really interesting, different kind of environment for me this year because we don't have a stand.
Yeah.
So for the first year ever, we are void of stand and instead we are free roaming, kind of free range, grass-fed Chapman Guitars people. And just kind of really getting to enjoy NAMM the way that I wanted to when I was younger,
yeah.
Much younger than I am now. It's been 10 years of NAMM shows, actually 11 years of NAMM shows for me. And so this is the first time I'm untethered.
Nice one. Is the 11 years including the one you missed last year? Are you counting?
You can omit the one that I missed, but I was making babies, so you got to give me time off for good behavior.
Well, of course.
Was it good behavior?
That's it. You're a busy man. You managed to squeeze that in as well. Squeeze it out. Maybe that's the way to put that one. Now, before we talk about all that's going on with Chapman Guitars, because you've always got loads of ideas, loads of things in the pipeline, let's talk about Clockwork Wolf, because that is, fantastic release. It's, it's doing so well, but it's even surprised you how well it's done, hasn't it?
It really has. I mean, I just, it's Americana blues rock. I don't think that my following were really expecting me to come out with an Americana blues rock thing. Mm. I'm known more for the progressive rock, for the heavier stuff, especially in the Andertons demos when I'm hired to be the shred gun guy. And that's one thing that I do, but really I am, if you cut me in half, half of me would probably be like Peter Green, Jimi Hendrix and Billy Gibbons and all the bluesy good stuff. And the other half would be the more hard kind of Carnival, Metallica, Tool kind of vibe. So it's been really liberating to release kind of blues, slide playing, dirty filth, and then have people buy it a lot.
Yeah.
That's been nice.
Yeah.
So it's opened lots of interesting doors. It's taken me by surprise. And to be honest, I'm kind of quite relieved because putting out a body of work in the best of circumstances is a nerve-wracking thing to do. But when you're known for something else, at least it wasn't K-pop.
Yeah, absolutely. No. I did wonder with this because you have got, it's difficult to not get pigeonholed into some, and in some ways you kind of want that as well early on because you want people to grasp on to something and then you develop as an artist and you'd go in different ways. Now, obviously, we've followed your ups and downs with your vocals, you've been very open about the challenges you've had, problems you had early times on the road. How is that now in comparison, looking back over the decade of you really learning this craft and now you're just like a fully fledged artist?
Thank you for the fully fledged artist compliment because it's weird. I feel like I am what I do. And for example, when I'm doing a lot of Chapman guitars, I feel like a guy that owns a business and then I play guitar on the side. Mm. And when I'm doing a lot of touring, I feel like an artist that has a guitar company.
Yeah.
So it's a weird environment to find myself in. My singing was something that I took on because I really needed to. The singers that I worked with over the years, it just didn't work out, lots of different reasons. And I kind of realized that I needed to take responsibility for my own music. So I reluctantly began yodeling and was shit. And I just did that kind of brave face, keep going, it'll work out kind of thing for several years, which probably was the wrong thing to do. And then eventually I got a lesson. That really helped, surprisingly. It just unlocked a million doors and suddenly I found I had more range and I could sustain for longer and I could use heat and it wasn't a problem. I could scream, all this kind of crazy stuff. And it's really nice to know that kind of given a couple of weeks notice for a live performance, I can get myself into shape. I can be a vocalist live, especially with a great band, playing some of the tricky, stupid riffs that I write.
Sure.
So it's nice. It is really hard work. Hats off to vocalists. It's much harder than anything else.
Yeah, and now in terms of performing these, will the guys get to hear this on the road? Are you going to take this band out?
Absolutely, yeah. We're currently in the midst of booking up for stuff for 2019. We're going to be announcing a bunch of dates pretty soon, so keep your eyes and ears tuned to all of the relevant social media sites if you'd like to come and see a giant, hairy, middle-aged guy perform some blues rock.
Absolutely, and just the guys will, I'm sure you've mentioned it many times already, but just so that they know, your work with Bia and all that's going to carry on.
So I actually do three things. The third thing isn't really released yet. So Dorje is myself, Beer, Ben, Dave, prog rock. We're working on the album this year. It's going to be released next year. Clockwork Wolf and Company is another album this year that will be released next year, maybe early this year, sort of late end this year. And Nothing Stops. It's just that I have more than one kind of vibe. When I don't sit down to write a tune. I'm just jamming, having a coffee, listening to some whatever, Yngwie, Peter Green, whatever it is. And then I get a vibe and then I write something and then I kind of, it either comes out bluesy, Americana kind of stuff, or it's very clearly prog rock. Mm. And then it sits in either one of the bands. Very occasionally, it's an instrumental, shreddy, Satch Vi kind of vibe.
Yeah.
And I am also in the middle of recording an instrumental album.
Wow, okay. Excellent, excellent. So any ideas when we might get to hear some pieces from that?
I really don't know, because it's the weirdest thing to record. It's based on various landscapes like ice cave or desert or the ocean.
Okay.
And I'm using a whole series of sounds, natural sounds, to create a band environment within which I shred very subtly and nicely and slowly. So it's a completely different kind of project, and something that as a result is taking longer to record, especially with a little tiny boy needing to have a nap.
Who are you doing this project with?
Me.
It's just all you.
Well, a lot of me, but a really, really amazing guy called Graham May. Okay. Graham May was the bassist in one of my first bands, The Black Hand. He's an incredible bassist. He used to play bass for a bunch of really, really, really cool bands. And he is also a sick engineer. And he's been programming and working on a lot of backing stuff for me, and then taking the guitar and producing it. He's kind of managing the project while I send him on the fly guitar files.
Nice one, nice one.
I did just bump into Devon Townsend and became a three-year-old girl. And I'd love to see if he'd like to be on it at some point.
Yeah, well, you know, we can't wait to hear some more of that. Now, let's cover Chapman Guitars 2019. You've got something lovely sitting right there. Is this something that the guys can get their hands on soon?
Yeah, sure. So we got a couple of things launched. We've got an entirely redone standard series. So the standard series guitars, they're manufactured in Indonesia. And this year we found a new factory in Indonesia. And it wasn't that we hated the previous one. We just wanted, it's like continual search for the ultimate recipe that makes a great guitar. Mm. Part of that is consistency. And the factory that we found, the lovely guys that own it are incredible. And we just made a bunch of guitars there. And we were like, okay, we just need to make our guitars in this factory. So we moved to this new factory. It's a completely different feeling instrument, which is not a spec upgrade that you can go, we've got new for this year, a thing. Mm. It's just that if you play them, they feel like a pro-end guitar.
Okay.
Rolled edges and all that kind of stuff. Really, really nice timbers. But the main feature that's been upgraded is the pickups. They're reworked from the ground up.
Okay.
So these are American magnets. They are tweaked and pulled around to be exactly how we wanted to do that. And the process of that is just myself, Beer, Matt, anyone at Chapman gets in a room and goes, what do you think? We go, nah. Where is it lacking? Record it. It's this area. Put it down, you know.
I think it's been quite refreshing to see the behind the scenes of a company like this, where you have been quite, you know, vocal about issues that you guys have had with different things over the time. And you've also been very keen on getting, you know, the fan base, the guitar players to give their input. So you do end up with, rather than launching a whole, you do launch new guitars, but those subtle tweaks that it's almost like it's just wood chipping, you know, every year just to make it that little bit better.
I mean, I think the thing is that we play them live, so they've got to be really shit hot.
Yeah.
And if they're not, you know, you kind of go, what am I doing? You know, it's got my family name on the headstock. My little boy's going to get this at some point.
Yeah, they're kind of like all your custom guitars. Yeah. Like you know. Now, with the hardware and the pickups, etc., that's on there, was there a particular reason why you wanted to really just completely control all aspects of it? Was it difficult to get?
Well, the more control you have over a product, ultimately, the more it feels like it belongs to you and what you're doing. And we're really, there are many positive attributes to having a guitar company full of guitarists, and many negative ones. And the negative ones are that everyone has an opinion, and you know, what feels great for a Beer will feel very different for Lee Anderton, for example. Or for Matt or for me, we have different shaped hands. Rabia has ogre hands. I have normal hands. And, you know, we play in different ways. You know, our hands sit on the guitar in a different way. So we want different neck gauges.
Yeah.
And we try and give as much of the design options to the public. But there are some things that you really can't vote on, like, you know, the profile of a neck. How can you say, well, it's going to feel this way? You can't. So we, you know, the four or five of us or whatever sit down and we feel things and we work it out and we tweak it to, you know, an average of where we would all like it to be. Mm. And that's always changing.
Yeah.
It's, I'll tell you what, though, it's really fun. Designing guitars is amazing. It is just, it's a continual process of refinement. And
like playing, I guess.
Yeah, no, it really is. Yeah. Because, and also, as you change as a player, you want different things. Mm. So releasing Clockwork Wolves in the Sunshine, playing more slide, for example, and using this guitar here, which is the semi-hollow, it was the GC exclusive. Now it's just a global.
Yeah.
For NAMM and NAMM, it's my favourite new guitar, and
yeah,
I love it, and I love the solid brass saddles and the P90s and all these different aspects.
I want to touch with these rings and
dude, you touch it with whatever you want. It's fine. This has travelled around the world and then to California again, so it's okay, indestructible.
Survived.
But I mean, now I'm playing a lot more slide, and when you're playing slide, you want a different kind of guitar. Mm. Different things work better different ways.
Absolutely.
It's a continual process of refinement. The new factory is amazing. The quality and the consistency are much higher, and they sound better, which is really nice.
Awesome.
But we haven't just released guitars.
No.
We've also released an entire new brand.
Right.
So many years ago, I was accused of being a snake oil salesman.
Okay.
Well, I get accused of many things. But there were a couple of people saying, oh, Rob's only in it for the money, he's just selling cheap guitars to kids, you know, this is awful, you shouldn't watch his videos. Yeah. Okay. And I thought, you know what, I will be a snake oil salesman. I'll start a brand called Snake Oil. I'll literally sell things branded snake oil.
Okay.
It's not a hoax. A lot of people thought it might be a hoax or a joke. It's just a really cool new Victoriana, Americana, slightly steampunk edged brand. And we're launching with these two new pedals. One of them is called Marvelous Engine. Mm-hmm. And the other one is the very thing that you need for Grey Tone. The very thing. And I literally snuck off on my own, worked with a cool designer friend of mine, and made them. And then I made these things. And Matt and everybody was like, wow.
Yeah.
When did you do that? I really wanted it to be a separate brand from Chapman.
Okay.
Which was a bit of a weird move, I suppose, looking from the outside in. But as an artist, as well as a company owner, I know that when you've got a deal or you're working with one brand really exclusively, for example, someone like Slash doesn't want to play a Chapman guitar. I mean, if you'd like to, you're more than welcome to. But there are artists tied in with another guitar brand that might want Chapman's giant social media clout, and so we can access them through a different brand.
I like that. I like that a lot. And you know, you are seeing that there are some brands that are going in that direction as well. You know, so you know that there'll probably be more of them copying that idea. But it's a very, very good idea. And of course, we have them here. We'll get some nice shots of them. Now, just so the guys know, because you know, it's one of these things that people do need to hear them before they can get inspired.
Well, I'll say we haven't reinvented the wheel.
Okay.
We just made the wheel pretty and made it in England.
Mm.
So, and they're not great wheels. It's just a boost overdrive and a distortion pedal.
Yeah.
You put this in front of a crunchy amp, you get the singing crazy high-end blue thing. Or you just boost. Yeah. Put that in front of a clean amp, you got a high-driven 800 kind of vibe.
Okay.
It's nothing outrageously different. I'm never going to lie to you and say this is the most groundbreaking thing you've ever heard. It's just
going to be like the Chapman brand has built that reputation. We know that it's quality, and you're going to get the same from Snake Oil.
Well, I had these prototype for about 5 months. I took them on my board to everywhere, and I had people like Pete Honore, Lee, Beer, Dave, all my social friend group. Tried them, tested them, I gigged with them, I recorded with them on the Clockwork album, and we refined them over ages and ages, tweaking frequencies, making loads of protos, and I'm really, really happy with them. Mm. And I'd never put out something that I wasn't happy with. So they're also handmade in England.
Right.
Which, whether or not you think it's worth spending a little bit more for something handmade in England, totally up to you. I did, however, come across a drummer today who said he wanted them just to hit. He wanted to put them on his stands and, like, cowbell type. He said, yeah, they're so pretty, I want to hit them on a stand.
I'd just have them to be on display, to be honest. It's a very nice design. So when can the guys get their hands on these?
I think we've got... Lewis, is it? Oh, you're not Lewis. You're Rocco. Sorry, there's a phenomenal guitarist behind us that looks very slightly like one of our retail managers. Is it March? It's approximately nearly 4 months. That was Danish, but I translated it into English first. So 4 months from now. But, you know, it's NAMM, never April, maybe May.
Well,
so
that's, you know, you say these things, and then when we try and get them in for review, it's like, right, yeah, we still don't have them yet. But since they're made in England, there's a good chance we can get our hands on them quite soon. Although we'll just take these away, that's fine.
You're Hello, sorry, yes? Yes, okay. Yeah, it's fun. It's really good fun. And what's interesting is, when you launch an entire new brand and suddenly, like, we were having breakfast in our hotel and we went, and that was it, the brand was launched.
Right.
We pressed a button and suddenly it existed from nowhere, whence it came. And now it's a brand that people know of and people are going, hey, when are you going to make a snake oil amplifier? I'm like, okay, snake oil amp, that's one vote for an amp. When are you going to make a snake oil banjo? Okay, banjo, that's... And I we take everything in and I think about it.
Yeah, well, you know, Marshall haven't done the microwave yet, so maybe that's one for you to...
I don't think microwaves are very good for you, though. I'd rather do a toaster oven.
Well, there we go.
That would be really cool.
George Foreman-style grill, you know?
Yeah.
That could work. So, you know, I was quite surprised to hear before we started rolling that you are... you know, you told us that you're retiring from Anderton's, which I was. No, of course you're not. You're never gonna do that. You'll be doing it until you.
Well, you never know. You're never say never.
But you know, you've talked a lot about, you know, your relationship with Lee and the enjoyment of doing these over the years. But something I've always wanted to know is, you know, you get with all the positivity that you get, there is still a good side of criticism, you know,
yeah,
and you guys never
Thank
sort of
God.
Shy away from that sort of thing. In the early days of building it, how did you sort of cope with that and also take from it to improve what you guys were doing?
I'll give you a really interesting window into my life that will give you, and if anyone, a lot of people watching this are going to be creators and they're going to have YouTube videos and Instagram videos and stuff. I hope this helps. So, for years and years and years, I got tons of shit from, you know, when he sings, he sounds English, that's horrible, he should sound American, or his hair is bad, or he's a bit overweight, or now he's skinny, now he's overweight again. He's got dreads, he's culturally appropriating, and it's all these words from people that make words. And then I saw a video of Slash jamming with Miles Kennedy, and there were lots of comments saying, ah, Slash is awful, he's mega overrated, he's never going to be any good, and I'm like, you fucking kidding me? It's Slash. And then I saw some comments saying, oh, Miles Kennedy's voice is awful, he's got bad technique, he's pitching. Like, are you having a laugh? It's Miles Kennedy. And I realized every single artist on earth just gets shit. Mm. And you know what? When you start to get the shit, it's because you're really making some headway. And I embrace the shit. I think it's important to say, you know what? When I start doing a thing, I'm not going to be very good.
Yeah.
It's the beginning of something cool. And I think... I remember when I started Chapman, people said Chapman would never go anywhere, no one needs another guitar brand, it's a waste of time. We're the biggest guitar company in Europe. I started singing, people said you're never going to be able to sing well, you've got an awful voice. I've had charting, in inverted commas, success, sold music and made some money. So I think if I stand for anything, if I have a superpower, it is that I just ignore the bad and reward the good. And I think it's really important to sort of stand still, take stock, and just realize that if you want something and you're prepared to sweat blood, more than likely, if you just keep going for it, follow your gut feeling and follow your brain less, because it tends to lie to you, you'll end up like a hairy middle-aged guy like me.
Who can start their own guitar company and actually ship snake oil.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I actually thought about, you've all got beards, so this is kind of relevant.
Okay.
I actually thought about making a fretboard oil that was also a beard oil that also came in a medicine bottle slide.
Right. I like it. Yeah, why not? Always full of ideas, Rob. Look, pleasure chatting. Best of luck with
these
new products.
Thanks, Nick. Thanks, Dave. And thanks to everybody watching this. I'm sorry I'm a little bit tired. I've been running around staring at iOS devices and
trying to avoid the crowds.
Yeah, and drinking American coffee.
That's it. If you're at NAMM, make sure to look out for Rob. He'll be here all week, as they say.
Yes.
And thanks for watching, guys.
Take it easy.